And now we still will be looking at who the Lord Jesus Christ is. We want to know who He is. We want to know what He did so that we can emulate Him. We can copy what He did. Okay? Once again, I ask you to join me in prayer. Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, together as your body, we come to you and ask your leading and wisdom as we study and learn more of your words. Holy Spirit, we pray that may you allow your servant speaker to deliver only the truths of your word through the precious name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. So open your Bibles to Matthew 16, 13 to 20. That's on page 588 on those black Bibles, the thin one. 588. It's under the seats, if you can have it. Yeah, okay. Of course, you can always use your electronic Bibles. All right, so follow me. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, He asked His disciples, who do people say the Son of Man is? Well, they replied, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others say Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets. Then He asked them, but who do you say I am? Peter answered, you are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Jesus replied, you are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from any human being, but I say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and all the powers of hell will not conquer it. And I will give to you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit in heaven on earth will be permitted in heaven. Then He sternly warned His disciples not to tell anyone that He was the Messiah. Additional blessings be upon us because of the reading of the Word. Amen. Jesus was already about 2.5 years, you know, in His ministry, that when the time that He said this to Peter and the rest of the disciples, He was already close to the end of His ministry. It's about 2.5 years. But at the onset of His ministry, He was unknown, right? Nobody knew Him, right? He needed to be introduced by His cousin, John the Baptist, right? He needed to have someone to introduce Him. But at this time, by the time 2.5 years later, He was well known. You know? Almost the entire population knew Him. Well, because of the miracles that He did. And not only that, because of the teachings that He said, that He made. And it angered the religious leaders of the day. You know, the Pharisees and the scribes, it angered them. And people were following Him from place to place, and everywhere He went, there's always a huge group of people following Him. Some of these people were ready to get up in arms and revolt against Rome. This is so much so after Jesus fed the 5,000, remember? With just two fishes and five small loaves, He fed the 5,000. And then, not long afterwards, 4,000 people with seven loaves of bread and a few fishes, right? He fed them, so they were ready to get up in arms and revolt against Rome. Would you imagine? I was imagining what the people were saying, you know. We have a leader that can feed us, so our economy will be okay. You know, we'll have a great economy. And then there's Jesus practically eradicated sickness in the land. There's no disease. So there's a healer, there's a good leader, and He's going to feed us. We want that to be king, right? That's probably what the people were saying. But Jesus refused to be an earthly king. He doesn't like to be an earthly king. After His massive feeding, Jesus revealed to them who the true bread of life is. And He said in John 6:58, he said this, I am the true bread that came down from heaven. Anyone who eats this bread will not die as your ancestors did, even though they ate the manna, but will live forever. His followers couldn't take this teaching. You know, who wants to be a cannibal? Right? Jesus was saying, eat me, eat my flesh. And they were Jewish. They were Jews. They cannot eat human flesh. And at this point, many of the disciples turned away and deserted him. Their followers? The followers, they deserted the Lord Jesus Christ. John 6:66. And Jesus, when he saw the people were leaving, asked the 12 disciples, are you going to leave me too? He said, are you going to leave me? Peter, of course, the spokesman of the 12, he said, Lord, to whom would we go? Where do we go if we left you? He said, you have the words that give eternal life. We believe that you are the Holy One of God. So Peter is speaking for the 12. He said, no, Lord, we're not going to leave you. You give us life. We're not going to leave you. And Jesus knew that he was about to be crucified at that time. And he was already preparing the 12. And when that happens, is who's going to be left following him? Who among these followers would be committed enough to continue the work of redemption that Jesus started? Jesus wanted to know that. So Jesus took his disciple away from the crowd. Jesus would always do this so that he had time for them alone, you know, so he could talk to them, converse with them, and pray with them, and have intimate conversations with the 12. Now, this was when, you know, in one of these occasions, one of these intimate occasions, this was when he asked the 12, who do people say the Son of Man is? Who is he? He didn't ask the people what the people thought about his works, because he knew his works, they're good, right? He did miracles. Or his motives, or his character. Well, nobody can put any blame on him. So his character was blameless, he was pure. He wanted to know what the people say, who he is. Throughout the 3 years of his ministry, people had their own speculations of who Jesus was. Some based it from where he was from, whose family he was raised. So they called him Jesus of Nazareth, Yeshua of Nazareth, right? The son of the carpenter. That can be found in John 1:45 or in Matthew 13:55. But after the great works that Jesus displayed among them, now they connected him with the Messianic era. Although they did not say that he was the Messiah. Some said that he was John the Baptist. This speculation was most probably originated from Herod himself, you know, King Herod, because he was the one who killed John the Baptist. And his guilty conscience made him think that just John the Baptist rose and went back to life. And of course, the opinion of the king will spread like wildfire. And that's why they say, that's probably John the Baptist, right? Some said he was Elijah, the prophet. They must have based this from Malachi 4, if you would go there, Malachi 4, 5, and 6. It says, look, I'm sending you the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord. His preaching will turn the hearts of the peoples to their children, and the hearts of their children to their fathers. Otherwise, I will come and strike the land with a curse. People must have compared the fiery preaching of Jesus to that of Elijah, who denounced sin and plainly condemned the hypocritical attitudes of the scribes and the Pharisees and the unbelieving people. But to see Jesus as a forerunner was to miss seeing him as the Messiah, the anointed one of God. I'll say that again. To see Jesus as the forerunner was to miss seeing him as the Messiah or the Anointed One of God. Still, others saw Jesus the one as one of the prophets. They say, oh, he's probably one of the prophets of old. Yes, he was unlike the teachers of the law. You know, the Pharisees? He's not like one of them, who merely quoted what was written in the Talmud. You know? Jesus, when he spoke, he did it with authority. He proclaimed. His preaching was with authority. Just like the prophets of old, they had their messages directly from God. That's why they spoke with authority. And that's why Jesus spoke with authority, because he spoke directly. His message was plain and with authority, but it was directly from the Father, from God. Some different speculations on who Jesus was, but the crowd did not see him as the Son of God. For 3 weeks, we have been studying that Jesus is the Son of God. He is God. When Jesus refused to be an earthly king like the people wanted and expected, they withdrew from him. And then, in a few weeks later, they killed him. Remember? Those very people whom the Lord fed with 5 small loaves of bread, 5,000 people of them, and then 4,000 again, they were the very ones who shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" You know those people who went before him when Jesus was entering Jerusalem and shouted, "Hosanna, Lord, save us!" They were crying, "Save us, Lord!" They were the very ones who shouted, "Crucify him! Kill him! We don't want anything to do with him." So Jesus asked them point blank, personally, "Who do you say that I am?" That is what concerns Jesus then, and it is what concerns him now. I believe, who do we say he is? What is our personal belief in him? What is our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ? This cannot be dependent on what our parents said they believe in. If we grew up in the church, you know, we grew up in Sunday school, it's not dependent on what our Sunday school teacher said that we should believe in, or what our parents said that we believe in. It's all dependent on your relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. You may have been raised in the church and was surrounded by Christians all your life, but you still have to, at one point in your life, decide who Jesus is in your life. Not what your Sunday school teachers say, like I said earlier, or your preachers might say, but what you say. Who do you say Jesus is in your life? Now, Simon Peter answered. It's in verse 16. Peter said, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." He's referring to the Lord Jesus Christ. Peter's reply cannot be more precise. It was exactly who Jesus is, the Christ or the Anointed One. In ancient times, you know, we get anointed. You get anointed if you're either a prophet, a priest, or a king. Now, that's what Peter's confession of faith. The question is, what is our confession of faith? When we say Jesus is the Christ, we say that he is the prophet who gave the direct and unfailing message of God. We say that he is the high priest who offers the sacrifice for forgiveness of our sins. When we say that he is the Messiah, we say that Jesus is the King of Kings, whom we obey in humility and without question. Also, to say that Jesus is the Son of the living God is to say that Jesus is divine, that Jesus is deity, that Jesus is God as well as man. Peter then, at that time, you know, when he was surrounded by his peers, it was easy for him to declare that, correct? It wasn't difficult for him, you know, when his faith was tested, but it became tough when his friends were all gone. Not even a year later, remember? Peter, when he was already on his own, in the courtyard, when Jesus was about to be tried, what did Peter say? I don't know the man. When people were asking me, hey, you were with him, you look like a Galilean, you should know him. But Peter said, and he said this three times, I don't know him. He even cursed saying that. The most revealing test of our faith is not what we say during Sundays, where we are surrounded by believers in worship services. That's not when our faith is tested. The true test of what we say or what we do and who we are in our actions during work days, from Monday through Friday. That's when the test of our faith will be passing through the fire. Who do you say Jesus is? In your actions, in your words, do you declare by your actions that Jesus is God? Let me tell you something that should inspire you. When a person stands up for Jesus against a crowd, he doesn't do it all by himself. You are not alone. You think you're alone. You think your friends are not with you. But no, you're not alone. If you're already a believer, right? And you already accepted the Lord Jesus Christ. When you profess Him as your God, as your Savior, just like Peter, when he professed his faith, Jesus said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of John, because the Father in heaven has revealed this to you." You did not learn this from any human being, but you learned it from the Father. Also, you'll find it in John 16, 13 to 15. Jesus said to his disciples, when he was already preparing for his departure, that's in page 649 in your Bibles, it says there, "When the Spirit of truth comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own, but will tell you what he has heard." See, the Holy Spirit telling us of what he has heard from the Father. "He will tell you about the future. He will bring me glory by telling you whatever he receives from me." Jesus telling the Holy Spirit what to say, and telling the Holy Spirit inspiring us what to say. "All the philosophy of the Father is mine. That is why I said, the Spirit will tell you whatever he receives from me." We do not see or hear Jesus ourselves, but the inspired record, the Bible, of what he said, what he did and said, convinces us. When we confess Jesus, it is not the result of mere intellectualism or guessing the right answer. No. God convinces us, God working through Jesus, through the inspired writers, through the Holy Spirit, that recorded the works and words of the Lord Jesus Christ. That is what inspired them, and it is what inspires us as well. As Peter declared Jesus' identity, Jesus reaffirmed the name that he gave to Peter when they met the first time. You know, in John 1:42, Jesus gave Simon the name Cephas. Remember? Jesus said to Simon, "You are Cephas, which means Peter or Petros in Greek, meaning a small stone or a gravel or a broken stone from a huge mass of a bedrock, of a boulder. The boulder is Petra in Greek, right? Notice how the Lord switches words. I say to you that you are Petros, and upon this Petra, I will build my church. That's how Jesus said it. And he did it. Jesus will not build his church on someone that is fallible as anyone else. For all have sinned, and that includes Peter. He wasn't infallible. You'll find so many instances, even after the resurrection and ascension of the Lord Jesus Christ, that Peter needed to be corrected. He needed correction. He was corrected by the Apostle Paul because he made mistakes. The church would have been on a shaky foundation if Jesus meant that the church will be built on Peter, right? But what Jesus meant, what he was going to build his church on himself, it was very clear that Jesus meant that. He said, he will build the church on himself. All the powers of hell will not conquer it. And Jesus did prove so. Satan attempted to kill him, but the grave couldn't keep him. He arose from the grave, just like he said he would. Jesus is the founder and the foundation of his church. Remember when he said to the Pharisees, he said, the Pharisees asked for a sign from him. And he said, you're not going to get a sign from me. You already had a sign. A sign from Jonah. And that's what you're going to get from me too. I will be buried in the heart of the earth. And I'll stay there for 3 days and three nights. Just like what Jonah did in the heart of the whale, in the belly of the whale. I'll be inside the earth, I'll be buried for 3 days and three nights, but I will come back to life again. And hallelujah, he did. Amen? Amen. He did. There's a very significant responsibility that was handed over to Peter. In verse 19, it says there, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven. And whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. Peter opened the kingdom of heaven to everyone who believed and received Jesus. He was the first to preach the gospel of salvation. If you remember Acts chapter 2, he was the very first one to preach the gospel of salvation. And the number of those who believed, if you remember, and they got baptized right away, was 3,000 souls. 3,000 men believed and received the Lord Jesus Christ. He was also the first to bring the good news to the Gentiles. He was the first to the Jews, and he was the first to the Gentiles. He first baptized Cornelius, if you remember him. Acts chapter 8, he baptized Cornelius and his entire household, and they were Gentiles. I'll read to you Acts chapter 8, verse 4 and onwards. That's page 649 in your pew Bibles. But the believers who were scattered preached the good news about Jesus wherever they went. Philip, for example, went to the city of Samaria and told the people there about the Messiah. Crowds listened intently to Philip because they were eager to hear his message and see the miraculous signs he did. Many evil spirits were cast out, screaming as they left their victims. And many who had been paralyzed or lame were healed, so that there was great joy in that city. It's beautiful, right? Later on in Peter's life, finally, he understood. Listen to what he wrote in his first letter in chapter 2. 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. It says there, oh, that's in page 739 in your Black Bibles. It says there, you are coming to Christ. Who are the living who is the living cornerstone of God's temple? Peter was referring to Christ as the cornerstone of his temple. He was rejected by people, but he was chosen by God for great honor. Now he's referring to the people. And you are living stones, Petros, that God is building into his spiritual temples. What's more, you are his holy priests. Through the meditation of Jesus Christ, you offer spiritual sacrifices that please God. Now Peter is saying, just like him, we also have the keys to the kingdom, that we may open the gates to people who don't have a relationship with Christ yet. You see, when the keys were handed, the keys of the kingdom of heaven was handed to Peter, Jesus did not. I believe that Jesus intended for Peter to hand it down to everyone who believed as well. So that everyone who believed may be able to preach the gospel as well, and so that the gospel will be handed out throughout all generations. And that's the very reason why we have the gospel right now. It was handed down to us by everyone who received him. Now here's something that I want to leave you this morning. The word of God is calling for obedience. It calls for obedience. Either you're already a believer, or this is just the first time that you have heard about Jesus. He calls for obedience because he is the Son of God and has commanded that everyone must receive him as Lord and Savior. But there's only one way to heaven. There's only one way, and that's through our Lord Jesus Christ. Do not listen to the lies of the devil saying that if you're good and if you do good, you don't need Christ in your life. That's a very big lie. I mentioned earlier at the onset of the message, John 1:12. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. The right to become a child of God is attained only by believing and accepting the Lord Jesus Christ. There's no other way. Let me say that again. There is no other way to heaven. It's only by and through the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you have never done this before, and this is not the first time, it's just the first time that you've heard of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you've never accepted him, well, now is the time. Let me ask you to accept him and step forward and step up and receive him as your Lord and Savior. Now for those who have done so already, here is the challenge for us. For each one of us, you have the keys that were handed down to us. Each one of us, we have the key to the kingdom of heaven. If we preach, if we reach out, if we share the good news of the gospel, we are opening up the gates of heaven for those who do not have the Lord Jesus Christ yet in their lives. We are to use these keys to open the kingdom of heaven to those who don't know Jesus yet. We are to welcome them in the house of the faith. That is the vision and mission of Kingsway Christian Church, to recruit and train and make disciples, make ambassadors for Christ, starting here in Scarborough and to the ends of the earth. And may the Lord Jesus Christ and his Holy Spirit help us do so. Amen.